So now we are live, ma'am.
Thanks for everyone for being here with us. We are now in session. Time to start our session. I am handing over mic to the Professor Dr. Tanu Tandon for formal opening of the today's live webinar.
Thank you, Mr. Alo, and good morning, everyone. All our audience who are there, and the esteemed panelists, and respected sir. So again, we are back on our Thursday Think Tank webinar series of Nirvan University. As we have always maintained, the Nirvan University, which is a fastest growing university here and relatively new, but we are striving hard for achieving the academic excellence and providing quality education to our students in multiple plethora of fields, including engineering and technology, management, agriculture, health, liberal arts, and tourism, yoga, to name a few. And in this pursuit to achieve the academic excellence and raise our bar higher, we have introduced this webinar series every Thursday, wherein we try to bring the global academicians and leaders on the platform. We have been trying hard to bring the people, experts in their fields, ranging from IITs to the institutes of national repute. And today in this series, I'm delighted to share that we have Dr. Ridhima Shukla of Department of Psychology, Christ University among us. Now, Dr. Shukla is an expert in quantitative field of quantitative research. She has more than 10 years of experience and has done evidence-based research on various topics, including emotions and psychological other issues. Plus, she has been a data analyst in a project of CARE India, and also a research officer in the Saksham project of Lucknow University. She's a gold medalist and net JRF of Lucknow University. And we are so happy that she is among us to share her knowledge with our students. To welcome her, I would like to give the baton to Professor Goyal, who is an inspiration and the guiding force behind this webinar series. He himself is a great researcher with various patents and awards under him. Recently, he has been conferred with Engineering Excellence Award by the Honorable Governor of Rajasthan. And I request him to kindly welcome Dr. Ridhima to begin the session. Professor Goyal.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. So good morning, everyone. First of all, on behalf of Indian Institute of Materials Management, Jaipur, and Nirvan University, Jaipur, I welcome you all in this webinar series. So I would like to welcome today's chief guest and keynote speaker, Dr. Ridhima Shukla. Ma'am, welcome. I would like to welcome my colleagues of Nirvan University, Jaipur, fellow colleagues from IIM Jaipur, Vice Chairman of IIM Jaipur, Shri A.K. Goyal Saab, Professor Tandon, moderator of this webinar series, and friends connected via social media across the globe. So as far as this IIM is concerned, IIM is having around 10,000 members with wide network of 52 branches and 19 chapters of professionals engaged in material management, responsible for planning, sourcing, logistics, and supply chain management. This Nirvan University Jaipur is incorporated by Act No. 2 of 2017 of Government of Rajasthan and promoted by Nirvan Charitable Trust. And we are running various certificate program, diploma program, UG, PG, and PhD program as per new education policy. And this university is located in the pink city of Jaipur. So once again, I welcome you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Goyal. Thank you. And we'll be discussing about the quantitative data analysis, which is extremely useful for our research scholars as well as all those indulged in research. And without wasting more time, I would like to invite Dr. Ridhima Shukla to start the session. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Dr. Tanu, for inviting me, and thank you all for giving me an opportunity to interact with the prospective research scholars and all the students who have joined us through being live there for all. So basically, I'm going to talk about the quantitative data analysis. I'll not be talking about the nitty-gritties which are involved in quantitative data analysis, because you know the time allotted to me is quite less, is very less. So including and talking about everything that is there in such a short period of time won't be possible. So what I've planned is for this particular series, what I'll do is I'll just give you an overview of how to go ahead with quantitative data and what kind of analysis is most suited for which level of measurement that you have. So we, as we all say, and as we all do as researchers, many a times we may be confused with whether to go ahead with a qualitative research or to go ahead with a quantitative research. So starting from the very basics, I'll just give you an idea about what quantitative and what qualitative research is. And then I'll talk about what kind of data is generated when you are doing a qualitative research or when you are doing a quantitative research, with the focus majorly on quantitative data analysis in today's session. So basically, as a researcher, we see a lot of things happening around us, and we may be influenced, and you know, we may be wanting to know why a particular occurrence or a phenomena is occurring. For example, when I talk to my students, many a times I see them, you know, when they interact with each other also, many a times I see them that while interacting with each other, somewhere they're down the line, they are not very comfortable with sharing everything with a single individual. So as a researcher, a question might come into my mind where I want to know that why this kind of a behavior is being, you know, manifested by students. So as a researcher, I might be intrigued by the question of why students are not very comfortable with each other. So this question of why would now lead me towards a method of inquiry or towards identifying or finding out the reasons for why a particular behavior is being manifested by a group of people. So here, as a researcher, I may come up with a research question, and this research question may be fulfilled or may be dealt with data that is generated. So when I say that, when I look at my students and I find them that few of them are interacting in a quite relevant manner with each other, and few of them are, you know, they are not very closer to each other. They are not sharing things. Even the academic buoyancy is not there when they are interacting with their family during their natural progression as students from one semester to the other semester. So for answering, for finding out the answers to the research question of why here, I might go ahead and plan a research. When I'm planning a research, chances are I can explore the reasons through asking them questions. And when I ask them questions, open-ended questions, they may come up with the answers. And they, when they come up with the answers, these answers could be in the form of, you know, elaborations of how they don't feel very comfortable in terms of interacting or sharing their academic journey with their peers or with their friends. So during this process of asking questions, I have many many options as a researcher. So as a researcher, when I'm going ahead with a quantitative focus or a quantitative mindset, it may be possible, if I might find, you know, as a quantitative researcher, I may ask them certain questions which might generate data. That data can be coded into numbers, okay? Or I can ask them questions which may be open-ended. I can ask them to share certain pictures of their lives, which they think that, you know, this because of this particular reason, they are not interacting with others. So the data that is generated through the form of numbers or in the form of numbers, generally that data is called as quantitative data. And when I'm gathering the questions, answers to my questions, research questions, through words and phrases and sentences, that data is not quantifiable. To some extent, it is not. To some extent, it is, yes. But here, the focus majorly would be on the words the person is using to express themselves, the phrases that they are using to express themselves, the language. So the data that is in the form of a language does fall in the category of qualitative data, whereas the data which is generated in the form of numbers, or if the data is generated even in the form of language, but certain numbers or certain numerals are assigned to them, and then we are measuring that, that falls into the category of quantitative research. So as a researcher, you always have an option of going ahead with the quantitative research or generating qualitative data for your research. While deciding which methodology would be best suited, a number of questions have to be answered by you. As a researcher, what you are planning, what kind of perspective you are taking up for your research, what is the research philosophy that is guiding you in terms of, you know, generating the data. So if your purpose is to identify the, you know, lived experiences of people, you will go ahead with the qualitative research. And if your purpose is to come up with something that is more objective in nature, and that can be, you know, analyzed using numbers or formulae, statistical formulae, then you generate the quantitative data for your research. So quantitative data analysis encompasses, it means that you are going to analyze the data that is majorly number-based. Okay. Just now I said that when I'm going ahead with a qualitative research, I can do a content analysis, quantitative content analysis of the data in the language form, where I try and identify that a particular word has been spoken, how many times in a particular duration of time. Then those frequencies, if you are identifying the numbers, here you are somewhere coding the data into a form of more quantifying it or quantifying it. So again, what I said earlier was that you have an option of going ahead with a quantitative or a qualitative research, depending upon what research philosophy you are having, what are the research questions that are guiding your research, and also through the qualitative data, you can quantify it, you can code it into quantifiable numbers, and that can act as a quantitative data for your research as well. Okay. Nowadays, many people say that, you know, quantitative researchers are not that good enough because here you are talking about the numbers, and how can a human experience or people's experience or lived experiences of an individual can be quantified or can be shown or can be manifested through a number. Whereas the people who are the proponents of quantitative researchers say that the qualitative researchers are not that good enough because here a lot of subjectivity and biasness could be there when you are interpreting the data. So again, now people have come up with kind of mixed methodologies where they substantiate and corroborate what their quantitative and what their qualitative data is saying or talking about. So basically in today's session, I will be focusing on quantitative data, how that is generated, and on what level of measurement you are generating that data, what kind of analysis is most suited for the quantified data that you have in your hand as a researcher. Okay, so proceeding further, some of the characteristics of quantifiable data or quantitative researchers is it is more structured research instruments. Okay, when I say structured, when I say research instruments, I'm definitely pointing towards the fact that the way or the methodology through which you are collecting data is structured in nature. Structured means that it is standardized in nature. When I say standardized, I reflect on a number of processes which are involved during the process of standardization. The very first is how you are going to administer your questionnaire or your tool or your instrument for data collection on the participants. So the administration of the tool has to be structured and well laid. Otherwise, you know, you will unnecessarily be including a lot of extraneous variances, and you might end up manipulating the extraneous variables as well, which will influence your research results later on. So as a researcher, the tool through which you are collecting your data has to be standardized. Standardization means that it has to be a specific way of administration should be there. Number two, the instrument should be reliable. By reliability is meant that there should be a consistency of results. For example, you have a weighing machine at your home and you step onto the weighing machine. On day one, when you step onto the weighing machine, it gives you a number. Let's say you weigh 50 kgs right now. After 2 hours, you again step onto the weighing machine, and the next time you step onto it, it shows 65 kgs. So do you think that a gain of 15 kgs within 2 hours is possible? That means there's something wrong with the machine. Maybe the machine, the weighing machine, the batteries are discharged, and that is why it is acting erroneously. Or it might be possible that the weighing machine has got something wrong with that. Okay. So the instrument through which you are collecting the data has to be reliable. That means it has to be consistent. If right now, if you are weighing 50 kgs and 2 hours down the line, you are weighing, let's say, 51 kgs, it is acceptable. Some here and there is fine, but a larger variation in this force is not acceptable. So such a tool which is not reliable is not considered to be a good enough tool or a standardized tool for generating the data. Because any which ways, when you are generating the data, you are going to analyze it. And when you are analyzing the data, you are going to share and come up with the external validity or generalizability of the results. So if your measuring instrument is not reliable, it will lead to flawed results, okay, which will have very limited external validity. Likewise, when it comes to the standardization process, the next thing that you have to keep in mind is the validity of the tool. By validity is meant that the tool measures what it is saying or it is intending it is measuring. Okay. For example, you come up with a tool where you say you are going to measure or assess an individual's personality traits. You want to check whether the person is an extrovert or the person falls into the category of an introvert. Here, if you are coming up with a personality tool, but eventually you end up having items or questions or, you know, scale items in the questionnaire which are not measuring your personality, they are measuring something else, let's say intelligence, definitely such a tool will not be valid. And obviously the data that is generated using such a tool would lead to, you know, improper conclusions. So the first thing as a researcher that you have to keep in mind, because whatever you are having in the form of a data is generated through the instruments. And when you are generating the data through the instruments, the tools have to be standardized. The second thing that you have to keep in mind when you are generating the quantitative data is that the larger the sample size, the more it would be representative of the population. Now, I have introduced a word here, sample, and a word here, population. So population is the entire universe on whom you can collect the data. Okay. So you want to check, let's say you want to see that in a particular district, what is the level of self-esteem that is distributed among a group of adolescents or for adolescents. Okay. So here the population is adolescents or individuals who are ranging from 13 to 19 years of life. So as a result, when you are generating or when you're going to collect the data would not be collected on the entire population of a district of having adolescents here, because limitations in terms of the resources, limitations in terms of the money, limitations in terms of the helpers that you have or the research assistants you have, tapping on the entire population is not possible. So here, using certain principles, using certain methodologies, you select a group of people who you think is representative of the population. You are not only thinking about it, but is actually the representative of the population. And then you are collecting data from this smaller group of people. And then eventually, once you have analyzed your data, you are going to talk about that this sample, if your sample is large enough, if your sample is representative enough, you can say that the results can be generalizable to the entire population. Okay. So population is the entire universe from on whom you are planning to collect the data from or on whom you are targeting as a part of your research. And sample is a group of people who are a smaller size, and you collect the data from them, which are representative of the population. Another thing when it comes to quantitative data, it is the high reliability of the quantitative data that is there. High reliability, why reliability? Because definitely the numbers would be interpreted in the same manner by no matter how many people are interpreting the same data. The same data set interpreted by me or by someone else would, using the same formula, we would come up with the same kind of results. So that is why quantitative data is supposed to be and considered to be high on reliability. Here, when it comes to quantitative researches, the research questions are more defined. They are clearly defined right at the beginning of a research, unlike the qualitative research, where you have an option of, you know, some kind of a flexibility in terms of reframing your research questions, provided you are able to logically justify why you are reframing your research questions. So here in a quantitative study, the research question guides your research. And once you have started the data collection process, the data analysis process, you do not have an option of going back and reframing or re-looking into your research questions. Here, the process starts from identifying the research questions, specifying the research objectives, collection of the data, analysis of the data, and coming up with the research results. Another thing which is a characteristic of a quantitative data is that all the aspects of the study are designed, carefully designed before data collection is proceeded, or you proceed in the direction of data collection. Here, the data, when you are going to collect it, the instruments, the hypothesis that you're formulating are well-defined, carefully designed, and only then you go ahead with the data collection. So the research design has to be in proper place. Only then you will be coming up with the data that is talking about the entire population. Okay? The data is represented in the form of tables, charts, figures, or any other form which is non-textual in nature. That is, you, because here you have numbers, so numbers can be displayed using tables, using charts, using figures, or any other method except for the non-textual forms. Here, because the data collection procedures, the instruments are reliable and valid, that is why, and you are very carefully selecting the sample size or sample of your study, that is why the results would have more generalizability, high predictability, and you can also investigate causal relationship between the different occurrences or different phenomena, which is again not the case when it comes to your qualitative research. Proceeding further, when I'm saying that I'm going to generate the data can be generated at four different levels. Now, when it comes to analysis of the quantitative data, one thing which is extremely important is the fact that the kind of measurement, level of measurement that is used to generate data determines what kind of analysis is most suited for that data set. So if you have a data which is nominal in nature, you cannot apply higher order statistics onto it, because such kind of a data has a tendency of changing its, you know, shape, and that is why the population parameters might not be followed when it comes to nominal data. So here I've written four words: nominal, ordinal, interval, and ratio. Nominal is the lowest level of data, which is generated by, you know, if you want to quickly identify how many people in your class are willing to give a test, you come to the class, you ask them how many of you are interested in giving a test. Few would raise their hands and say yes. Few of the students won't raise their hands, and they won't say yes. So here, this kind of frequency or counting the heads would be a part of your nominal level of measurement. So here, the data is more categorical in nature. How many of you are living in a nuclear household, and how many of you are living in a extended with the extended family or in a, you know, joint family? How many siblings you are having? So you may have one sibling, you may have two siblings or three siblings, depending upon. So such type of data, which is very basic in nature and which is used by the researcher to identify something very quickly, that is what your nominal data entails. The second level of data, which is a little better than the nominal one, if your research provides you an option of generating some little better data, is ordinal in nature. Now, when I say a little better, because in ordinal level of measurement, we can rank order people based on certain characteristics, and we can also calculate a little more defined descriptive statistics, which is calculation of median. Okay. So when it comes to nominal and when it comes to ordinal, ordinal is the second level of measurement, which is a little better than nominal because you have more options of, you know, doing something with the data. So here in the ordinal data, the crudest example is in a class of 10 students, the student who gets the highest marks in a test is ranked 1. I can see someone talking. Please mute yourselves. Radhesham ji, I would want you to mute yourselves, please. Radhesham ji, you have to mute yourselves. Yeah. So ordinal level of measurement is where you rank order people based on certain categories or based on certain characteristics. So in a class of, let's say, 10 students, you give a test to them. Once they clear the test, out of 10 marks, the highest scorer is ranked as 1. And the person who gets the least marks is ranked as 10. So here some kind of ordering or some kind of ranking is possible. Now, a little more advanced form or level of measurement is the interval level of measurement. Interval level of measurement is assumed to, you know, there are is assumed to be developed on equally appearing intervals. The best example of it is you might have come across a lot of questionnaires which ask you to rate your level of agreement or level of disagreement to a particular statement that is written in that particular questionnaire. So here, this is a Likert rating scale, or which is basically on an interval measurement. Here, the points from, if I have a 5-point Likert scale, then you can visualize it as on a scale, or you can keep 1 as the strongly disagree thing and 5 as the strongly agreeing part. So if you are strongly agreeing to a particular statement, you give a score of 5. If you are agreeing to a statement, you give a score of 4. If you are neither agreeing nor disagreeing, you give a score of 3, 2 for disagreeing and 1 for strongly disagreeing. Now the distance, the scale distance between strongly agreeing to agreeing and agreeing to being neutral is the same one, is the similar. So equally appearing intervals are there. Generally, people say that interval level of measurement is nothing but the ordinal one. But here, if you're having a composite score, for example, if you're in your questionnaire, if you have got 10 items and you total them, summate them towards the end of the questionnaire to come up with a composite score, the problems of ordinal ranking of each statement is taken care of. So interval level of measurement is considered to be a little advanced version of the ordinal measurement. And here you have more options as a researcher to work on the interval level of measurement. So you can apply a little more higher order statistics on the interval data. Then the last one is the ratio level of measurement. And if you look at this particular slide, you can have, you know, there's equal spacing between the response categories. There is an absolute true zero, which is there in a ratio level of measurement. Now, when it comes to all the physical sciences, the data that is generated is can be on a ratio scale. But when it comes to humanities and social sciences, then in that case, the ratio level of measurement for a particular psychological attribute is next to impossible. Why? So when I say this, why so? The reason being that interval level of measurement, there are equally appearing intervals between the response categories, but there is no absolute zero. Can you have you met an individual who is just having zero personality traits? That is just not possible. Okay. So here, when I say that interval level of measurement is a little better than ordinal, but a little poorer than the ratio level of measurement, still interval level of measurement is something that is used many a times by most of the researchers who are working in the area of humanities and social sciences. Because the reason being, there is no absolute zero when it comes to human psychological attributes or measurement of the same. So with the interval data, you can calculate the mean, you can calculate the median, you can calculate the mode as well as other higher order statistics, provided your data set is following the population parameters, or if your data is following, into if you're plotting the data, and if it is following a normal probability curve, if it is not skewed, then definitely you can go ahead with higher order statistics on the interval data that you have generated. So as a researcher, there's a little bit of, if you are in physical sciences, if you are a scholar of physical sciences, you can go ahead with the ratio level of measurement. But if you are a scholar of humanities and social sciences, ratio level of measurement is quite impossible to achieve. Now, the next step is, once you have generated the data following any of the levels of measurement, the next step is to analyze the data. So when you analyze the data, the first thing that you need to do is the data preparation. Obviously, when you are generating the raw data, many a times the raw data might not be comparable with other factors. So in such a scenario, you will have to transform your data from, raw scores to perhaps, let's say, 10 scores or 9 or something like that. When you are generating the data, when you give the questionnaire, administer the questionnaire to people, few of them might not give responses to all the items that are there in the questionnaire. So in such a scenario, you'll have to prepare your data accordingly. And if you're not preparing your data properly, definitely you'll be coming up with not so good quantities. So the first step for analyzing the quantitative data, even before deciding on the analysis or the statistical analysis part of it, you have to prepare the data for running out or carrying out the analysis. The first step is considered or called as the data validation stage, where you screen the data and check or remove all the questionnaires that are incomplete in nature. Because many a times, when you are administering the questionnaire, people might not be very willing to be a part of your study. So they just give the answers based on some kind of a response set or a response bias. So they just randomly click or randomly, answer the questions as all the items are strongly agree or all the items are strongly disagree. So you have to screen whether the data set is having any kind of response set or response biasness or not. One more thing that you have to check when it comes to generating the quantitative data using questionnaires, one little drawback is that because maybe you have not shared a proper rapport with them, so maybe they are not giving you the right and genuine responses. So in that case, you have to screen whether your questionnaires that you are having a data set that can be analyzed using different statistical methods. So screening is one thing that you have to keep in mind. Another thing is the completeness of the data set that you are generating. Once you have screened and found out that out of, let's say, 500 responses that you have collected, 490 responses are prim and proper, then you proceed for the next step, which is considered or called as data editing, which talks about the basic data checks or checking for the outliers. Here, I'm introducing one more word, outlier. Outlier means those responses which are towards the extreme category or towards the extreme scores. Generally, when you are generating the data and when you are going to do the descriptive statistical analysis, you will find that few of the outliers or few of the scores are unnecessarily escalating your mean or are, decreasing your mean to a large extent. So in such a case, you have to let go of those outliers and then proceed with the analysis. Again, if you're calculating the median for your data, if you're calculating the median, or if you're going to do a median as a descriptive statistics, then in that case, outliers will not be much of an influence. But if you're going to go ahead with mean as your descriptive statistics, then definitely checking for the outliers is a must as a researcher, because mean tends to be influenced by outliers. And mean is the basic central tendency that you are going to, that you are going to analyze your data for. And on mean, a lot of other requirements are based. Like, for example, if you want to go ahead with the standard deviation, calculation of the standard deviation, You need to have the means. If you're wanting to go ahead with the Pearson correlations, you need to calculate the means if you're using a particular formula. Okay, so mean is the basic crux of any central tendency of any research or any data set that you are analyzing. So you have to ensure that if your mean is your descriptive analysis that you are going to do, then you'll have to check for the outliers for sure. Okay. Here, when you are doing the basic data editing, you'll have to check for the other kind of responses that might be there. For example, while entering the data on your spreadsheet, instead of writing 5 as a response for a particular individual or particular item, you end up writing 1 or 15, or you may end up writing 5050. So here you have to run a basic data check to identify while entering the data on your spreadsheet, you have not committed any kind of mistakes in there. The third step is the step of data coding. Many a times, like I said, we generate the qualitative data and then quantify it in terms of numbers. For example, for each, for each category of, or for each demographic details that you are taking up, let's say for gender, you can assign a number of 1 if your respondent is a male, and all the female respondents can be coded or given a number of 2. Okay. And people who prefer not to say which gender they belong to, you can assign them a number of 3. So the number 1, 2, and 3 here definitely convey a very important meaning in terms of demographics of the individual, or in terms of the gender of the individual or gender of the respondents of your study. Okay. So here, through data coding, what you are doing, you are transforming the qualitative data or the demographic data into meaningful numbers. Okay. Likewise, people who are living in a nuclear family can be assigned a score of 1, and people who are living in a joint family can be assigned a score of 2, so on and so forth. So all the demographic data that you are generating, you can code that data into the form of numbers. Now the next step, or the fourth step, is data transformation. Many a times the question asked through which you are collecting the data may have some reverse keyed items. So in the process of data transformation, you ensure that you are transforming those reverse keyed items into the correct codes that they are supposed to be in. Okay. Along with that, many a times the raw scores are not comparable to each other. When I say comparable to each other, I mean to say here that it may be possible that you give a group of students a test, 2 tests, 1 on the English ability and 2nd one on the numerical ability. The test was very difficult for the numerical ability, but very easy for the English ability, for assessing the English ability. Here, so if an individual has scored out of 20 on English ability, they have scored 19. And out of 20 for mathematical ability, if they have scored a score of 10, if you look at the data, 19 for English, 10 for maths, but you are not knowing the difficulty level of the items or the questions, you may end up comparing both the things, and you may end up saying that the individual is having a better English ability, language ability, rather than the mathematical ability. When in fact, this is not the case. Because here, 2 things are representing something which is there. So here, as a researcher, as an analyst, you have to transform your raw scores so that they can become more comparable. So there are various methods through which you can transform your raw scores into more standard scores for doing comparisons. So Z score transformations are there. T-score, capital T-score transformations are there, then you can convert or transform your data into STENINE, that is standard 9 set of scores, or STEN scores. You can also convert your scores into percentiles as well. So as a researcher, when you are about to analyze the data, first of all, you'll have to prepare your data for further statistical analysis that you are subjecting your data to. So step 1, data validation has to be prim and proper. Step 2, data editing has to be effective. Step 3, correct coding is required. And step 4, if required, you transform the data. If not, then you proceed with the next step, which is the data analysis. Now, when it comes to data analysis, quantitative data analysis, majorly there are two kinds of analysis that is done. One is the descriptive analysis, and the second one is the inferential statistics or inferential analysis that you do for your data. When it comes to descriptive analysis, you describe the data. Here the purpose is to describe the data set to help or to help understand the details about the sample. So within descriptives, you identify, you just come up with the central tendencies and with certain dispersion scores, so that you come to know whether your data set is, you know, can be used for further higher order analysis or not. As a researcher, the first level is, even before saying that one variable is going to influence the other variable or you are going to establish the causal relationship, first of all, you'll have to assess what is the level of that variable that is distributed within the population. So through descriptives, you identify how a particular variable of your study is distributed within the population. Okay. So here, the first step is to get, again, a macro and a micro level view of the data set that you are generating. By macro level is meant, on the whole, how your data set is appearing to be. Is it following the population parameters? If it is following the population parameters, you have an option applying parametric statistics. If the data set is not following the population parameters, you will not apply parametric statistics on that data set. So population parameters mean that the distribution, how the distribution of the population of the data set is. Are majority of the people falling near about the mean? One, you know, there's a specific, scores that are there on a normal probability curve. So approximately 68% of the people fall between mean 2 plus minus 1 sigma. Sigma is the distances on the normal probability curve, on the baseline of the normal probability curve, or from the mean. So in and around the mean, 68% of the population must fall if your data is following population parameters. And only very few people should fall on both the sides or both the ends of the normal curve. So here you check, you gain how much your data set is skewed towards the left or skewed towards the right in terms of, coming up with the right or identifying the right kind of inferential statistics that you are going to apply. Second thing is, with the help of descriptives, you can identify the potential errors that you might be committing. So for example, if you have generated the data on interval level of measurement and you have calculated the mean, but there are many outliers because of which the mean is either inflated or deflated. Here, this is the right time that you will help, that will help you to analyze whether you must go ahead in the direction of removing the outliers or keeping them in your study. Generally, ideally, the outliers analysis is done. If there are few outliers, you let go of that data set. Definitely, that will decrease sample size, but it will increase the external validity of your research results. Last thing is, you get informed about the kind of inferential statistics that you are going to apply. So when it comes to statistics and descriptive analysis, these are a few of the things that you calculate. Mean is calculated as a central tendency. Median is calculated as a central tendency. So is mode. So when you have data on the interval level of measurement, the best central tendency to be calculated is the mean, which is considered to be more stable in comparison to median and mode. But at the same time, if there are a number of outliers, you will have to look into what you are going to go ahead or do with your outliers, or what you are going to do with the outliers, how you are going to analyze them. If your data set is, if you have collected data on the nominal, on the ordinal level of measurement, median is a better central tendency for description of the data set. Okay. And if your data is on the nominal level of measurement, it is generally advisable to go ahead with the identification of mode as the central tendency of your data set. So mode is the most, in a very crude manner, mode is the most frequently occurring number that is there in your data set. Median is that point which divides the data set into two equal halves. Again, it is that point, it is not a number that is there. Median is that point which divides the data set into two equal halves. That is, 50% of the population would fall above that particular point and 50% of the population will fall below that particular point. Mean is considered to be the average of the performance of a group of people on whom you have collected the data. So for calculation of the mean, you take into consideration all the scores together, divide it by the total N, summate all these scores together, divide it by the N, that is the total number of respondents in your study, you get the mean. For the median, it is that point, identification of that point, which would divide the data set into two equal halves, and mode again is the most frequently occurring number in a given data set. Now, based on the, you know, doing the descriptive analysis, the next step is the calculation of a standard deviation, which is, standard deviation is a measure of dispersion of scores around the mean. So how many scores are dispersed around the mean? What is dispersion? What is the extension of scores around the mean? So higher the standard deviation, that would mean that the raw scores might be, from the mean, there might be a lot of deviations from in and around the mean. If you have a very smaller standard deviation, that would indicate that the dispersion of scores is not that much. All the scores are falling near the mean. Next, Next is the calculation of fractiles, which are considered to be, when you have a data set, you divide it into certain parts. That is what your fractiles are. So you can go ahead with the calculation of quartiles, deciles, or percentiles. So if you are dividing your data set into four equal parts, you will calculate the quartiles. If you are dividing your data set into 10 equal parts, you will be calculating deciles. And if you are dividing your score range into 100 equal parts, that is where your calculation of percentiles would come. Next, which is a very defining moment for any data set, is the identification of level of skewness and kurtosis. So skewness basically means how much the mean, median, mode are not falling on each other on when you plot the data on a graph. Skewness means the data set might be positively skewed or the data set might be negatively skewed, meaning that the data might be towards a higher end or the data set might be, leaning towards a lower end. So if your data set is following the population parameters, all the three measures of central tendency, that is the mean, the median, and the mode, they all would be having or falling at the same point. But if the mean and the median are not falling at the same point, the data may be skewed. To some level, for identification of whether your data set is parametric in nature or not, some level of skewness is accepted. Higher the skewness, the data is considered to be more non-parametric in nature. And definitely, if your data set is non-parametric in nature, you will not apply the parametric statistics for analyzing the data. I'll talk about that in the next few minutes from now. The next is the inferential statistics. Once you have collected the data, run the data analysis, and identified the descriptors, the next step is the identification of inferences about the population. So here, you go ahead with the hypothesis testing, which is a part of inferential statistics, which is a little higher order statistics in comparison to the descriptive ones, because descriptives only describe the population parameters, only describe the sample statistics. But when it comes to, when you are analyzing a study, when you are analyzing a study or conducting a study, generally you analyze how different groups may be acting differently. What kind of a relationship might be existing between variables? How one variable is predicting the other variable? So all of these things are a part of your inferential statistics and also the hypothesis testing. So when it comes to statistics and inferential analysis, you have t-test. When you have two groups to compare to identify whether group one has performed better on some test group two has performed better on some tests, then in that case, you will go ahead with t-test, which is also, you know, which was given by student, basically comparison of groups in terms of significance of difference between them. Is the differences in the groups, are they just because of some, casual factors, or are there specific reasons for the differences among the two groups? That is where you calculate the t-test. You see that you observe that males and females are having different levels of self-esteem. So you analyze self-esteem among males and among females, and you run the t-test on the data set, and you identify that the if your t-test results are significant, you interpret it as the higher the mean of a particular, a self-esteem among males is indicated because of certain factors which might be influencing or which might be the reasons for differences in the self-esteem. When you have more than two groups to compare and you go ahead with more than one variable in your study, or more than one independent and more than one dependent variable, then you go ahead with ANOVA, ANCOVA, or multivariate analysis of variance, MANOVA. It is also, ANOVA is also called as F test. It was given by Fisher, where they do comparisons among a number of groups at the same time. T test has a limitation that you can compare only two groups at a particular period in time, whereas ANOVA has an option of, when you have multiple groups to compare at the same time, you can run the ANOVA and you can find out the relationship, or when you can find out the cause-effect relationship between variables. Okay. The third kind of statistics and inferential analysis is the correlation. Correlation talks about how two variables are associated with each other. Now, when I say two variables are associated with each other, what is the magnitude of the direction of relationship between these two variables? Here, when you are doing t-test or ANOVA, you compare the groups on a single variable, whereas when you are doing a correlation testing, you have to have two variables on, and you have to have the data on a single set of respondents. So unlike t-test and ANOVA, where you have one variable and two groups, in correlation or correlation analysis, you have two variables and one group of respondents. So for example, you want to check that how does personality traits and self-esteem are related to each other. How do they relate to each other? You will find out the association between them. The strength of the association, the magnitude ranges from minus 1.00 to 0.00 to plus 1.00. If the relationship is in the positive direction, that means that both of them moved together in the same direction. If the strength of the association between the two variables is in the negative direction, you interpret that one variable increases, the other decreases. But here, no efforts in terms of cause-effect relationship is being done. Here, when you are doing the correlation testing, you just find out the association between two variables of your study. Then, if you want to talk about that, how does one variable predict the other variable, then you will have to go ahead with the regression analysis. Within regression analysis, there are a number of regression analysis that you go ahead with. There's a multiple regression analysis that is there. Plus, you also have stepwise multiple regression analysis, forward analysis, backward multiple analysis, n number of methods of regression analysis is there. Then the another kind of inferential statistics or analysis is path analysis, where you make a path between how different variables are related to each other. How does one variable lead to the other variable, and that leads to the third variable? So that is where you go ahead with the statistics in path analysis. So if I just give you a test selection overview. So here, if I just give you this, then the type of analysis, you have two association between two variables, or you compare two groups. If you have if you're going to find out the association between two variables, for the parametric statistics, Pearson and simple linear regression would be used. If you have non-parametric or ordinal level of measurement, the Spearman correlation would be used. Few values which are non-linear association or nominal, you can go ahead with a chi-square or a Fisher exact test. So basically, if you are trying to associate, or if you're trying to find out the association based on two variables, there are different set of statistics to be used differently for parametric and non-parametric data that you generate. Okay, so you'll have to check the population parameters. You'll have to check what kind of or what level of measurement you have used, and then decide whether you will go ahead with the parametric statistics or whether you will go ahead with the non-parametric statistics. If your analysis is to compare two groups, you have an option of different groups. That is the same, the same variables are represented in the different groups. Here, if you have two groups, then perhaps they are different from each other. You can go ahead with the independent t-test, or if your data is non-parametric or ordinal level of measurement, you will go ahead with Mann-Whitney u-test. If you have a repeated measures design, and that is repeated measures means that the research design where same group of people are studied different variables at different points in time. So you have a single group of people on whom you are going to measure their weight, then their height, then their texture of the hair, then their color of the eyes. Here, repeated measure design is used as a research design. And if you have non-parametric data or ordinal level of measurement, you'll go ahead with Wilcoxon test for analyzing the data. And if you have parametric data, then you will go ahead with paired sample t-test. So you have a single group of people on whom you have first collected the baseline data, you have intervened or administered an intervention, and then after the intervention, you want to check whether there are any changes, you will go ahead with the paired t-test. If you have more than two groups to compare at the same time and the data set is parametric, you'll go ahead with analysis of variance. If your data set is non-parametric, you'll go ahead with Kruskal-Ballis. So this is a very brief overview of what statistical analysis is all for. And I'm open for questions now. If you have any questions or queries, you can ask me now. If there are any questions, I'm open for the questions right now. I've given a very brief overview because, the entire analysis in 1 hour is just not sufficient.
Are there any questions, Mr. Alok?
We have received a very wonderful response from Facebook audience, which are connected through the online. Everyone is appreciating the content and the way of the presentation which we have received through the ma'am. So it is very wonderful and nice session, ma'am. Just from the Facebook connection, I have received no single questions, but a very lot of good appreciations.
Thank you. Thank you so much to all my audience. Although I cannot see you, but yeah. So if you are not having any questions, I assume either you have not understood anything or you have understood everything.
No. That's the contrary part. That the point is that they have understood. And since there are no questions, so I would like to propose a vote of thanks. And it was a pleasure having you with us, Dr. Ridhima. And as Mr. Alok rightly mentioned, it's a vast field, as you said, Dr. Ridhima. And moreover, when we talk about quantitative data analysis and statistical analysis, it's a vast field, a little complicated for the novice research scholars as well who have just started their journey. But your presentation was very comprehensive and it made the thing seem so simple, sorted, and easy to relate to. So I'm sure and I'm hopeful that all those research scholars and researchers who have been part of it, we now have got a tentative idea of how to go about it and how to select.
Yes.
So I thank you again for giving such wonderful presentation, which was so simple. It's very, very difficult to present a complicated thing in a very easy to understand manner. And that is what you have done.
Thank you.
So again, thank you, and looking forward to having more sessions with you in future.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anuman. So thank you all for inviting me and giving me an opportunity to interact with people here. Thank you very much.
Thank you.